I greet my viewers with another liberal message from such a liberal politologist and international observer, progressive international observer like me, Armen Agnoshenyan. Again, you can actually send your feedbacks, you know, to my email. Email is the following: armenak.nouridjanian64@gmail.com, and I'll return your feedbacks promptly. Well, actually, today I want to pay attention and to American electoral campaign. It sometimes sounds so ugly that one Republican presidential contender, Senator, yeah, youthful Senator from Florida, Marco Rubio, started calling Republican frontrunner, businessman and conman Donald Trump, started calling him con artist, and publicly, and Donald Trump called him con artist back, and as Marco Rubio, he actually truant in Senate, and he doesn't show up at most of Senate sessions, and you know, he just stays at home and doesn't go to the Senate, you know, and the Senate floor, and they can actually duck his pay, you know, for that, or fire him, you know, from his senatorial job, as he is a truant, he didn't show up at work. Which actually was quite just criticism upon Donald Trump. In the second, but Donald Trump, I believe, that figure, right-wing figure, extremist, you know, from New York City, he a businessman, he used to be a successful businessman, but he actually turned con artist as he founded unaccredited and unlicensed Trump University and conned thousands of students out of their tuition pay. And that's how he became rich, you know. Because he was con man, he shut down that Trump University on students and stole their tuition. And I believe that courts in New York City will find him liable and responsible for for paying restitution to those students and giving them back their tuition money. Hopefully. And I hope that Republican frontrunner Donald Trump will lose the elections, the general elections, and though he is likely to be nominated as a Republican nominee because he got the majority of those delegates, Republican delegates, and he is number one frontrunner in the Republican Party, and he's not popular among Republicans. Which is his greatest. But a couple times, on two occasions, I can mention that Donald Trump had a schizophrenic episodes. First time, his encounter with Fox TV journalist Megan, what her name was, female journalist was Megan, when Donald Trump mentioned that he saw some blood on her, but there was no blood, not whatsoever on her, none of her face and none of her body, and then so it was actually a visual hallucination that Donald Trump was having at that time. So it may be counted as a schizophrenic episode in his life. And then the second schizophrenic episode, my term as such, you know, from a medical description of his episode, as he had an interview at a town hall with CNN, with CNN moderator and CNN star, Cooper Anderson, Cooper Anderson, and he called his Republican underdog contender, presidential contender, Senator, Texan Senator Ted Cruz. He called him Rafael. He said that real name of Ted Cruz is Raphael. But this untrue. And again, Donald Trump was having a delusion, which is also a symptom of schizophrenia. So, Donald Trump, I believe that he had two schizophrenic episodes, which I believe that he should better pay attention to his treating his growing schizophrenia, because otherwise he might have more psychotic episodes like this one. And in the second, he wants to build a great border wall on the border of US and Mexico, and at the expense of Mexican government, which is unrealistic, I believe it will never happen, as Mexican government will not pay for such a wall. And in the second, even Donald Trump decides to do racketeering, as he said, he's gonna shut down money transfers, money transfers, and was sending remittances, you know. He wanted to shut down remittances of money coming from Mexican immigrants back to Mexico to their relatives, and he's gonna use it as a blackmail device, a blackmail to blackmail Mexican government into paying for the U.S.-Mexico border fence. This outrageous. I mean, I never believe that a Republican candidate will resort to extortion and racketeering against a foreign government, against the government of neighboring us country, Mexico, in order to poor Mexican country serve right-wing extremism in America. And this is outrageous, and I believe that if Donald Trump becomes U.S. president, that relations with Mexico will be severely undermined and will be worse as ever in American history. Like, it will put USA and America on the path of war, but it will be definitely a cold war if Donald Trump implements all those threats against Mexico and Mexican immigrants, you know. Like he promised to deport all Mexican, 11 million Mexican immigrants, which is cruel and unusual punishment and unconstitutional, I believe. And I believe he is, as a conservative politician, he actually, he's a right-wing extremist, and at least half of all Republican constituents are the same stuff, you know, of the same dough. They are right-wing extremists. They want to deport all those 11 million undocumented immigrants, most of them are Mexican nationals, and I believe that outrageous, and Democrats instead of earned pathway towards citizenship, well, I believe an amnesty, overall amnesty to some, to most of those illegal immigrants who actually managed to establish jobs, vocational professions, you know, on American territory, and actually should be allowed to have permanent resident status and consequent U.S. American citizenship, as we actually must respect human rights and grant was permanent residency to non-criminal illegal aliens who have stable employment in the United States, I believe. It will be delivered probably by Hillary Clinton, the liberal Democrat, the more liberal liberal Democrat from New York City. And I believe that Hillary Clinton was telling the truth when she told that he had Republicans as her enemies. But actually sometimes our political candidates, they talk delirium, you know, and that delirium somehow encroaches on their speech and then befuddles their intention, you know. And then unfortunately delirium sometimes messes up their political intentions. So that he says he wanted to say that Republicans were actually political opponents, But he didn't have a single Republican enemy. He didn't have a personal enemy in her life, you know, that would come from Republican field, you know. And me too. For me, like a liberal Democrat, Republicans are just political opponents, but I didn't have any enmity with them, none whatsoever. there was never enough personal for me. And let's be disagree without being disagreeable. So I believe both sides, you know. It's, I had a few friends who were Republicans, but, you know, and then I believe that most of Republicans, of course, quite decent gentlemen, you know. And but some of them, of course, are right-wing workers, you know. too. What about Hillary Clinton? I fully endorse her Democratic nomination as a Democratic presidential candidate, and I believe she's way more electable than that communist sympathizer, that so-called Democratic socialist or independent senator from Vermont, U.S. Senator from Vermont, Mr. Bernie Sanders, who actually voted against Brady Bill, against gun control, opposed gun control, and was in the hands of gun lobby. And what can I say, that he didn't take money from corporation? I don't know, he took money from corporation or not. It remains his personal mystery, you know. Because now he counts $42 million as his election money, and he claims that large corporations or gun lobby, you know, that is not contribute to his political campaign, you know, but it actually might be, you know, it's actually his political myth, you know, his propaganda, political propaganda. But he was communist sympathizer because he sympathized Cuban communist regime, and Cuban communist regime is not a democracy, it's a dictatorship, and it was known for persecuting political dissidents, for persecuting pro-capitalist, pro-democracy activists, for persecuting homosexuals, and cracking down on political dissent, and putting away their opponents, Communist Party opponents, behind bars. It was just there and expressing the public discontent with the system. And actually, he Bernie Sanders was U.S. independent, not a Democrat. Senator from Vermont, he actually sided with the Cuban communist system, which kept Cuban people extremely poor. Cuban workers make $25 a month. On the salary of $25 a month, you cannot physically survive. Even if you buy the cheapest food, you won't have money even to buy food during 30 days of a month. And you cannot even maintain human life at that kind of money. But with this kind of salary, like Cuban workers have, they cannot live half starved, you know, starved to death. In starvation, I don't believe that communist system should actually exist, because and he wants to make a U.S. education system communist as well. He wants to make colleges free, so that colleges didn't make any money, so college professors didn't make any money as well, and the purpose, you know, he wants America live like communists, you know, because he himself communist sympathizer. Definitely. About it, Donald Trump was quite right to call him communist. He was a communist sympathizer, at least. That's a fact. and then, when I believe that, come to speaking of a minimum wage issue, recent, $15 an hour minimum wage bill signed by Democratic governor Edmund Jerry Brown is a high hallmark of working class struggle that reached its peak, you know, and And an example of Democrats sides with people, you know, working class people, you know. Democrats sided with working class people and signed legislation to raise the minimum wage. Republicans would never side with working class people. For instance, Republicans in Georgia, Alabama, they keep workers working for how much? For $5 an hour. The state minimum wages was southern states like Alabama, Georgia, $5 an hour. Imagine, and then and they keep workers in extreme poverty. No, American workers, all stuff, in extreme poverty, and they actually, you know, that kind of politicians, that kind of definitely enemies of working class people, you know, and up to keeping working class people in extreme poverty, abject poverty. And also Hillary Clinton, the Democratic front runner and future, I believe, presidential candidate from Democratic Party, she actually proposed $12 increase to $12 an hour of federal minimum wage, which is progress measure and should be done, and it should improve the plight of working class Americans who live in abject poverty. Like 45 million Americans live below poverty line. I can't quote, unfortunately, cite with source of my quotation, because it's actually, I don't remember where I got it from, somewhere from U.S. press, you know, was one of some of the journalists who mentioned it, but it might be a very dubious figure, you know. I'm not sure about it, you know. I was sent for a quote in one source of information, especially a highly contentious one. And talking of contentious information, I want to mention that Bernie Sanders, I was just shocked by Bernie Sanders' racism, because rule and divide kind of politics, Bernie Sanders, that the Democratic underdog or independent senator from Vermont, you know, he's sure a leftist, but he was actually he once mentioned that started dividing unemployed people to black and white, and then there is no black unemployment in the United States of America, no white unemployment in the United States of America. There is no such statistics that can support such contentious and highly controversial opinions on unemployment, as were quoted by independent senator from Vermont, Mr. Bernie Sanders. You know, and well, actually, because official unemployment statistics, you know, overall, in the United States of America, according to U.S. Department of Labor, is 5.9% official unemployment. And if we, some people try to say that no, unemployment is bigger, we just suffer with delusions. Unemployment statistics is just what have been actually what have been quoted by U.S. Department of Labor, not ours. And they try to ballyhoo, you know, paint their own delusional pictures on unemployment, with like Bernie Sanders was talking about black unemployment, which is sky high in his opinion, but it's untrue. It's untrue, because there is no separate statistic for blacks or whites in the United States, because the U.S. Department of Labor hasn't gone racist so far. Atlanta. The second, that what about the racism in American press? What has happened? Well, I was reading Smart News. Somebody mentioned, one journalist mentioned, you know, white privilege or kind of bullshit like that, you know, which is untrue too. And figment of one's sick imagination. All people are equal in the United States, and everybody getting the same, has the right to the same minimum wage or the same social economic conditions. Like anybody else, and maybe except for some, with the exception of some movie stars, handful more stars. But since American workers now they pay low wages, and then well, actually that kind of socioeconomic premise, you know, of low wages of American workers, majority of American workers, it actually is, impedes, you know, economic development and prosperity, economic prosperity, and impedes growth of stocks and bonds, and as people buy less commodities, and have to scramble for bargain deals, and they actually cannot actually buy their own housing and stuff like that. And I believe that maybe, you know, economic condition will improve in the United States somehow since the passage of $15 an hour minimum wage bill, which will make minimum wage by year 2012 by annual increments of $1 and annual increments of half a dollar per year on annual basis in California, in the state of California, and also in New York City. New York City, we say in New York City or in Pennsylvania, on the state of New York, in those parts, $15 minimum wage. We had Governor Mario Cuomo, first time in the United States history, and then the living minimum wage has became living wage and minimum wage. Actually, minimum wage got the quality of a living wage, and actually politicized the working class people. That's a great victory for working class people, of course. And by year 2020, hopefully we'll all see the fruit of the loom, you know, see the fruit of those progressive politics, see the benefits of those progressive politics. And hopefully American workers will get out of poverty, and progress politicians such as Hillary Clinton. And I ask you, my viewers, you know, to support Hillary Clinton as a progressive politician, like she is. She's fully electable, and more electable in general swaths of populace on the U.S. Constituents. When Bernie Sanders, who is actually a communist sympathizer and wants to make United States educational system the way communist countries used to have it for free, you know, this kind of approach, communist approach to education, I believe that it's not a good idea, because it make American teachers poor. So it's, I believe it's not a good idea, and there are certain also mechanisms like deferments or forbearances that keep that protect poor students from you know, from vagrancies of paying for tuition. Yeah, and then what else I want to cover? Also, international events. I want to cover that handling of President Obama, the terrorist group, Islamic State. A group of Islamic extremists who actually executed a number of people, including Matsune, what they call Shia Muslims were executed prisoners of war, Iraqi soldiers and Syrian soldiers, and were kidnapped journalists and international aid workers, and executed them too barbarically by cutting off their heads. You know, we actually had children recruited and turned them executioners of war's Western hostages. And I believe that President Obama should sanction, should order U.S. troops to attack those positions of Islamic State militants in Syria and Iraq by a massive attack of massive strike of U.S. troops, Shark troops, and wipe them out with one single strike. A terrorist group. that way we'll be able to liquidate 30,000 militants in one single fell swoop. And actually we'll rid of that Islamic terrorist group altogether. But President Obama, he unfortunately he opposes committing boots to the ground. You know, he opposes sending U.S. troops to Iraq and Syria, which will capable of hitting the Islamic State militants. You know, and wiping them out entirely, completely, with minimum casualty. And then the second, whoever becomes next U.S. president, I hope that Hillary Clinton will commit U.S. troops to wipe out Islamic State, and will send U.S. troops to Syria and Iraq to wipe out the terrorist group and liquidate its capital, Raqqa, in eastern Syria, and we'll actually capture all the rest of the world's Islamic militants, so we wouldn't be able to hurt innocent people anymore, because we execute all those Christians, Yazidis, non-Muslims, Muslim Shia groups. We execute Shia Muslims as well, because Sunni Muslims, there's mostly Sunni Muslims against Shia Muslims. But this is outrageous. I don't understand. Why should religion play such a great role in human life? But it's way safe to be simply an atheist. And then, as a scientist, I'm scientific atheist, also, because I have to believe in truth of science, you know, in order to actually to operate as a scientist. Well, religion requires belief in supernatural miracles, which never occurred. And I don't believe in non-religious miracles and stuff like that, because it's impossible to believe it. There is only human society, and there are forces of nature, and there's nothing else, never was anything else in human history, mankind's history. Well, there is no such thing as a God, I believe. So that if you want to have any reflections on my beliefs, and please, okay, so send your feedback to my email armenak.nourijan64@gmail.com, and I'll definitely will return your messages. I will be glad to receive your missives. Thank you so much for attention.